Hey man, should I come in with the toys?
What?
Yeah, what do you think?
I think it's gonna look good without them.
What do you mean? This has character.
You got plenty of character, man.
Not enough. Ask away. First question, girl.
First question.
Let's do this.
Hey guys, so before we start get going here, thought I'd introduce myself to you. I'm Robert Godinez. You might have guessed it, my name was just on screen. So here's the deal. I'm a film and marketing student at Cal State Long Beach, and I'm making this short documentary as my directed study project. This project is going to be about comic books and graphic novels. They're extremely interesting to me because I am such a huge fan. They say to make projects about stuff you love, so that's what I've done here. So to prove it, here's the stuff I keep on my bookshelf. This is what I'm reading right now, but anyways, back to what we're supposed to be doing. Comics and graphic novels, their industry, their fans, are what we call a marketing phenomenon. By that, all I mean is that their consumption of them comes from not a logical place, probably more of an emotional connection. We're a relatively small pocket of people who love and read comics and graphic novels, but we make up such a large industry. An industry that, according to Comicron and ICV2, had their sales rise every year from 2011 to 2015. And in 2015, topped $1 billion. So, I've split the documentary into two parts. For part one, I'm gonna try to explore the why of it all, meaning why comics and graphic novels? Why do they connect with people? To do that, I sat down with some hardcore fans to talk about their takes and why they love comics. So we'll start off with Steve and Vera. Steve is a 23-year-old freelance video editor who works at a movie theater as well. He has the coolest place I've ever seen anybody keep comics. Yep, right there in his drawer. Literally below, like, underwear and socks and stuff. And above pants. So, you know, whatever that's worth. He's also got them up there in the shelf. He's got a few of them scattered around his room. Steve's a big fan of DC Comics, as you can see. They're probably his favorite company. He loves just the richness of the characters, and he loves the villains that they have as well. He's got quite a few collectibles. He loves Hot Toys and Funko Pops and all the different figures and stuff. Posters, memorabilia, everything. He's not just about comics, it's genre stuff of all mediums. He also loves Carnage and Venom, and Spider-Man is where his roots lie. One of the highlights of Long Beach Comic-Con for him was getting his figures signed by Jay Lee, the artist whose designs the figures were based on.
I got signed by Jay Lee. It's pretty awesome.
Who is it?
He's an artist.
Who's the character?
It's Wonder Woman.
Now, as cool as Wonder Woman and Steve are, I interviewed a lot more people for the documentary. Let's go over them really quickly. Daniel Gonzalez, a 24-year-old bartender and screenwriting student. John J. Morales, a 17-year-old high school senior. Betty Escorcia, a 21-year-old recreation aide and psychology student. And Nathan Torres, a 22-year-old film student. The first thing I asked them is if they had a first memory of being exposed to comics, or how comics found them.
I was probably 7 or 8 years old. It's when I would buy a lot of Spider-Man toys, and these are the ones that it came with a comic book, whenever you purchase it, you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So, like, I would open it, you know, play with the toy, and then I remember perfectly. It was Ultimate Spider-Man number one.
But the first time I actually had an actual comic book and got really into it was at a grocery store. We were waiting in line or whatever, and I saw this cool JLA comic. This was when they used to sell them at grocery stores. And I just saw the pantheon of all those characters, Batman, Superman, the long hair, Aquaman with the hook, and like badass Wonder Woman, just buff. And you, as a kid, you're like, whoa, that's a lot of superheroes. Like, I want to get that. And I begged my mom for it, and she's like, no, no, no. And finally, she bought me it to shut me up. And from there on, I just got into them, you know?
Then a couple years ago, my cousin went out and bought Batgirl and Miss Marvel Volume 1. And we read them. I read them immediately, pretty much. And they got me hooked. And ever since then, I've just been buying a bunch.
When I was younger, my dad used to always collect like toys and stuff, so I was always like around like X-Men and like Power Rangers and stuff like that. So obviously, like, those toys come from the characters of comic books, so I was exposed to that. He collected comic books, but he didn't really read them, so I was the one that would always go through his box and be like, ooh, what is that? Like, I want to read that. But I guess appreciate it as much. I was just more like a toy person, but I slowly got into it because of my dad.
And, you know, first view of comics would be like on Sunday comic strips, because, you know, as a kid you want to see like cartoons, something you can enjoy. At the time I didn't, you know, understand fully the jokes. It was just nice drawings, and, you know, I think that's what attracted me to investing myself a bit more into comics.
You know, all those answers are really interesting, and it gets doubled because when you think about walking around Comic-Con, seeing all these different kinds of people that are all into this, you know, united by this one thing, they couldn't have all came from the exact same place. Now, I had a lot more questions, so we're going to go into sort of like a speed round for some of the most interesting things that I found out in all of my interviews. Here we go. What appeals most to you about comics and graphic novels?
It's just the way that it's so immersive that once you're reading, you just can't stop. And then there's always that cliffhanger at the end. The writing's really well done. You know, you can't, like I said, the art is just makes it better. And sometimes you can just put yourself in the story and imagine, like, man, if I was there, what's gonna happen? Would I help out? Would I do this?
I think it's just a different media that people take for granted. I think sometimes they're like, oh, comic books, or if you see like old movies, like the nerds that always get made fun of for reading comic books. But then in reality, they're kind of entering this other world that people aren't really exposed to. And they don't realize that through this form, people can reveal these ideas that are really hard to explain through any other media. So it's this unique form of opening like this new world.
You get to control the pacing. So if in regular books, you're reading through each line very carefully, so it's kind of just at the pacing of the writer. But if you're reading a comic book, the pictures and all the words are a little more spaced out, which gives you a little more control over how you want to read it.
The stories that, you know, kind of reflect what I'm going through or have like a really humane kind of thing going for them, even though they're superheroes or they're drawings on paper, you still see yourself in them. And there's just some stories too that are just so cool and wickedly creative and imaginative that it pulls you in.
Has being a fan changed you in any way?
I think being a fan of comic books has affected me. Personally, after reading a couple comic books in my high school years, I found myself going to comic book conventions, like the Kamikaze, that's Stan Lee's. I've also been to WonderCon and whatnot. So that definitely, you know, has triggered something in my head, saying, hey, you know, it's kind of cool. Maybe you can interact with new people, see like what kind of cosplays are out there. You know, it's always interesting to see like other fans, you know, who really like to put the time into showing that they love, you know, like a certain series or comic books in general.
What draws you into reading a certain comic or graphic novel?
But if it's something, you know, I'm in a comic book shop and I got my pull and I see the striking cover or, you know, this cool title, kind of pulls me over, you know. You know, cover artists know what they're doing. They want people to buy the book. So you go over and you check it out. I'll read a page or two, and if I'm not drawn in, then I put it back. You know, it's more about, you know, you have to have the audience engaged in a comic, and I think that's when I would buy something. But yeah, that's it. I usually follow writers and artists and stuff like that, but if I'm looking for something new, then I will legit stay in a comic book shop for an hour or so until I find something new that I'm like, this is promising, it's got the potential, never heard of it, I'm gonna check it out.
I think definitely when I first look at a comic book, I take the chance to like look at the art first. And then once that hooks me onto it, I'll read the first couple of pages. Depending on like, you know, how I'm feeling, sometimes I'll read more than a couple pages, and then eventually I find myself done with the book.
Like if it hits home, like childhood, like right now I've been reading like the Power Rangers comic book.
Oh yeah.
Because it appeals to, I mean, I was still young when the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers came out, but the comic book grabs me because I'm like, oh, it's a childhood, like I remember the Power Rangers, you know. Or anything related to like werewolves and stuff, because that's just like my thing. So anything with that, I'm gonna read it one way or another. I'm gonna read it. Anything with great art, I mean sometimes I just like look up like an artist I really like and I'm like, what comic books have I read? Oh, you know what, let me look for them.
One of the things we did for this documentary was take a trip out to Long Beach Comic Con. I'd never been to a Comic-Con before, so it was a really cool experience, and I got to go there with two of the people I interviewed for the project, Steven and John Jay. This is my cousin John Jay. He's got some interesting stuff to say.
Gary...
Oldman?
Gary Oldman. He didn't do it justice.
Yes, he did.
I think he did, but people didn't. He's like, okay, how come Commissioner Gordon's not cool then?
He's cool.
No. Do you see people wearing Commissioner Gordon shirts?
I mean, look.
Do you see people dressing up as Commissioner Gordon?
Despite getting into comics later than everybody else I interviewed, this kid does not mess around. He is an animal when it comes to reading comics. He reads flat out more than anybody else I've ever met in my entire life. He is a consumer of graphic novels. He's mostly drawn to Image comics, but really appreciates character-driven stories from the other companies as well. With how big a fan he is, John really loved Comic-Con. And since we're talking about it, let's go deeper into it. Going to Comic-Con for the first time, I think it's really cool to think about what it really means. Our culture has sort of accepted what it means to be a geek, to be a comic book lover. These are places where people like me, or really more exuberant, even more into it than I am, can go and be themselves. And I think that's really great that there's a place where, you know, you can do that and be accepted. Comic-Cons aren't just for fans of comics and graphic novels, but they're really for fans of all genre mediums, and you can go and find your place there. John and I specifically read a lot more books that are outside of the DC and Marvel range, and going to Comic-Con, you see a lot more, you know, memorabilia, books, people dressed up as these characters from the smaller companies. Going beyond the books, I think you start to look at a greater appreciation for what it really means to people. Comic books and graphic novels, despite just being great stories or things that people can get into in that range, they really give people a place to belong. When you think about sports or movies or even just fans of other types of things, like just regular novels. The great thing is that it brings together people in that certain way, in that certain fandom. And that's what comics and graphic novels do, and that's what Comic-Con's all about. You can have connections with people you never thought you'd have connections with. A place where it's cool to see your favorite artist and go buy a print, to meet them, to talk to them. A place where you can see your favorite characters and all these kooky, weird characters that you never thought you would see. You get to see stuff you never thought you would see as a comic fan, like the Lion Cat from Saga. I mean, I was out of money at that point, but I wanted that Lion Cat so bad. Hey guys, back again. So, now that we've heard from the fan perspective, I want to go ahead and shift the documentary over to a bigger picture. For part two of the documentary, I sat down with some of the professors at my school, Cal State Long Beach. I wanted to get their opinion on the recent boom of comics and graphic novels, and also their impact on our culture. I spoke with Chris Shaw, a comp lit professor who primarily teaches the comp lit class, comic books and graphic novels. Amy D'Souza, another professor who teaches the comic book class. Adam Moore, a screenwriter and video game writer who also wrote the graphic novel Vendor, published in 2008 by Viper Comics. And Bonnie Blackburn, an author and screenwriter who teaches screenwriting and fiction theory courses at the school. The first thing I asked them was, is there a certain type of person who becomes a fan of comics?
No. But I do think that different types of people have different relationships to graphic novels. And, you know, that's something that I think can infect, that it affects their engagement overall. Basically to me, there's certain kinds of communities that are tied to graphic novels. And I think that creates a much sort of stronger bond around certain texts or genres or traditions, you know. Whether it's, you know, fantasy or sci-fi, it creates a conversation around the tradition that I think certain people gravitate towards. So other people, you know, they may read some occasionally, but there's different levels of involvement. And I think that's key to what makes the form different from other kinds of literature, for example, and even maybe other kinds of art.
I do think there's a certain type of person that becomes a fan of graphic novels and comic books, but I think that audience is expanding. I think it's traditionally the male audience, but I think that we are seeing that audience expand for a variety of reasons.
We start with picture books, and it's very accessible to go from that into longer form reading. But some people just keep going into comics and then graphic novels, and it's become more literary. So I think I think if you got hooked in childhood, you might have continued that love. Maybe there are people who come to it as adults because they like the characters, they have an appreciation of art.
Why do you think there's been this recent boom of comics and graphic novels in popular culture?
I think maybe another reason is just the proliferation of it. It's sort of become the tipping point. Comics were just simple, a small niche kind of demographic that read them, and now they've proliferated, and with some of the watersheds like Mouse and Watchmen, these comics pushed into literature. And they were not just for, you know, teenage kids or boys.
Obviously things come in waves. You know, a couple of years ago it was all vampires and zombies, and television was inundated with crime shows and cop shows and hospital dramas, and now we're seeing this shift into more of the superhero genre is booming. Obviously, I think Marvel's cinematic universe, the fact that they're doing something very unique with that is helping. I don't know that I can say definitively that it's the reason, but I think that it's growing more popular, so people are more likely to go and check out the source material for these things.
The boom of comics in popular culture, in my opinion, is a result of the fact that we all grew up. Is that we started out reading comics, and loving comics and cartoons when we were kids. And then we grew up and we still like our graphic novels and we still like our comic books and our cartoons. And so we're not gonna necessarily let go of that just because we're adults. We are now the decision makers in Hollywood, my generation. We're the ones who are green lighting films, we're the ones writing and directing films. So obviously, we're gonna go and try to create that stuff that we loved as kids. And of course, I think the other reason is that it's making gobs and gobs of money.
Can graphic novels ever get to the place where they're respected as much as prose novels?
I think they are. I think it depends on who you are, you know, in terms of how you're ranking it. But if you look at the work of Alan Moore or Frank Miller or Neil Gaiman, who, by the way, is a novelist and graphic novel writer, some Alan Moore stuff is better than any novel I've ever read in my life.
What makes the medium of comics and graphic novels special?
What makes comics special is that there is no bounds to your imagination, right? When you're making a video game, or you're making a movie or a TV show, you are bound by budget constraints. They give you, you know, you can spend this much per episode, and even if you want to go to Mars in your episode, sorry, you don't have money to do that, right? You can't afford that. Same thing in video games. In comic books, the cost of a panel is the same regardless of whether it's two people talking or whether a planet is exploding.
It's the level of engagement from the reader. When we read novels, right, our eyes are used to moving in a specific pattern. We are passive. You know, think about how many times you've read a page and you're like, wait, what did I just read? And you have to go back and reread it. It's because you're passively, like your brain is processing each word, but you're not really engaging with the text. Comics, because it's a blend of both, forces you to be an active reader.
What it does is it makes us think about, I think, literature in a different way, not in this linear way necessarily, you know, where you go from start to finish. And so you could keep coming back to it. And every time you do that, of course, you get new nuggets of, you know, insight and so on. Oh yeah, look at the little piece in the corner. What are they doing there? And so the artist, I think sometimes knowing that, they will put hide little nuggets here and there, and the same in the dialogue and so on. And what it does is it also creates a dialogue. So, you know, while you're waiting for the next issue to come out, you know, you're talking with your friends, you're checking in about, you know, hey, so what happened there on page 38? What do you think that's about?
I think what makes the medium of graphic novels or comic books special is the way that it is a hybrid between prose storytelling and visual storytelling. So there's such a compression of information that happens in a picture. You know, the saying, a picture paints 1,000 words. A moving picture maybe paints 10,000 words. So it's in between. It's a very portable, accessible, you know, way to go somewhere between a film and a book.
All right, I'm back again. Sorry, it's the last time, I promise. So, all in all, I think it's been really cool to see all these different perspectives on comic books and graphic novels, something that I love. From understanding why fans love them, to seeing their place in our culture today, I think it's time to look at comics with a little more respect. I think that people are always going to be drawn to great stories, and right now, comic books and graphic novels is where those stories are. This industry has expanded, the readership has gotten way bigger, which means the future creators have gotten way bigger, and more diverse. Comic books and graphic novels are gonna keep going further and further as time goes on. This industry is here to stay, and it's gonna be going for a long time. Thanks, that's all I got.
Two, three, four.